All right, we've got clever comments already happening, so...
When's LL coming to Hong Kong?
All right, guys, so let's get started. There are a few people outside who we're going to have to, like, you know, maybe you can do Chinese whispers and just pass the word along to them outside or something using Twitter. All right? Or Facebook.
You stream it.
So let's get started. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to Social Media Week and to the Wall Street Journal. Who's from the Wall Street Journal in this room? Put your hand up. All right. Oh, you've got the paper version. One. Wall Street Journal, hand up. Go on, put your hand up. Don't be shy. There we go. Cool. All right. Who subscribes to the Wall Street Journal?
Same number.
You sad bastards. Who reads newspapers? Who reads newspapers on their iPad? Who likes their iPad?
Everybody do.
All right, so it's just after Chinese New Year, so I'd like to say, Gong Hei Fa Choy. Lots of people ask me for Lai Si. Lai Si Dao Loi is what you say. Gong Hei Fa Choy. Thank you. So I'll introduce our guest in a moment. He's got his bodyguards. If you work for Facebook, put your hand up now. These are Trevor's bodyguards. Say anything naughty and they'll hurt you. Especially Nicole, here. She's very violent. So, who has come here for the first time? Put your hand up. All of you have been here before? People outside queuing obviously haven't been here before. So who's come here because of Social Media Week? Nice. Is Jocelyn here? Jocelyn, are you here? Anybody from Impact Asia, the organizers of Social Media Week? No? All right, cool. So, Social Media Week has got a few events going on. Tonight, if you don't want to be here, you can do speed dating with Time Out Hong Kong. So, if you don't want to be here, leave now. Excellent. Also, we have the people from Deja Vu Lingerie. Are you here? One of the most attractive women in the internet in Hong Kong. Jingu, put your hand up. Ex-model has got a website, Deja Vu Lingerie. But that wasn't good enough, so they set up a shop. So if you want to get 30% off kinky underwear, go on Friday and Saturday to... Where is it? Hilltop Plaza in Hollywood Road. Okay? Or just come and talk to Jingu. Put your hand up again. Hand up. So who's come here from overseas? Fergie. Is Fergie in the room? And no, it's not a royalty with red hair. Fergie, are you in the room? Fergie Miller. No, not in the room yet. In the queue. How about Fergie runs Guildford Eye? Guildford, right? How about Andy Lee? Andy Lee, are you here, Andy? NBA. Kabam. Social gaming, thank you. All right, so let's just tell you some exciting things. We've got some prizes. Facebook have donated. Facebook and Deja Vu have got together. This is actually slinky underwear. This is XXXS. So if you've got a good body, wear one of these. So what we're going to do is, I've got a few of these. Later on, if you ask a good question, you'll get a free t-shirt. Right? And if you keep quiet, you won't get one. So we have prizes. We have... Where's Steve? Steve from Silic Concept. Steve has a really good company. It's called Silic Concept. Or Silicon Set. Silic Concept. HK is sponsoring these eco-friendly notepads. Third prize, very funky headset, second prize, and a set of 7 iPhone 4 covers. Okay. Seven. I'm losing my voice, so would you please keep quiet? We're gonna start now, okay? All right. Whoa, I like it. So a big welcome for Trevor, all the way from London. Trevor Johnson. Trevor, I warn you now, Trevor is not Mark Zuckerberg. He dresses better, he's better looking, but he's not as rich. So, thanks mate, for coming along.
Thank you, it's my pleasure.
Oh, volume, like it.
Volume.
So, what do you do for Facebook? Your title is Head of Planning and Strategy, Emerging Markets. What does that actually mean? What do you do?
Yeah, I wouldn't get too caught up in job titles at Facebook, given that we're still a startup. My role is probably best called market development. So I've been at Facebook for about 3 years. I started off in EMEA in the London office with Blake. My role is basically helping scale that market in that region. And now it's to help scale the Asian region. So we now have offices in Singapore and Hong Kong and Australia. So supporting the likes of Stephen and Jane in the local markets in terms of getting the proposition up, getting the teams in place and making sure we have a great proposition to service this market.
So you've just opened a sales office here, right?
We have, yeah. So we as part of Social Media Week, and I think Blake announced yesterday, we've officially opened our office in Hong Kong, in addition to our office in Singapore and in Australia. So it's a very exciting week for us.
Why does it take so long?
Because
you're a startup.
We are
move
startup.
Fast.
I mean, I've been at Facebook for 3 years. We've gone from a London office where it was two people. We opened up in the big markets in Europe. Now we're up to about 70, 80 people in Europe. And now emerging markets is a focus for us because now we have the resource, the opportunity is great, and the user base is here.
All right. So talking about numbers. I always see numbers for Facebook, and they're always focusing on America. So the last number I saw is 25 million new users a month. So how many users, or active users, is what you call them, right? Active in the last 30 days.
Yeah.
What's the total number of active users Facebook has today?
So our public number is over 500 million active users. So an active user is someone who's logged on in the last 30 days. So it's actually a pretty interesting company because I've worked in online for a few years. And it's probably the first company where we actually downplay our numbers in terms of we speak about active users, not unique visitors.
So AOL exaggerated its numbers.
Didn't exaggerate the numbers, but we've used an active user is someone who's different to a unique user or a unique visitor. So a unique visitor is someone who hits the URL, whereas with Facebook you have to log in, so you have to not only hit the URL but log in and be active.
So we talk active means in the last 30 days.
In the last 30 days, yes. Logged in the last 30 days.
So who in this room is not on Facebook? The barman haven't put their hands up, so that's really cool. I like it.
Who wouldn't know someone who's not on Facebook?
All right, you've got 500 million people. How many of those are in your kind of space, in Asia? How big is Asia on Facebook? Because when I read the figures, it says 70% of the users are outside America. So how many of those, how big is Asia on Facebook?
Asia is not only big, but it's also growing significantly. So in Hong Kong, we have around 4 million active users. Across the region, we have probably about between 50 and 60 million active users and growing. Indonesia is like
number two, right?
It's like number two, yeah. It's something like 35, 36 million active users, and again, growing significantly. So it's not just about what the user number is now, it's about how it's actually scaling and growing. And it's growing at a significant level. I mean, you've got figures there that say 25 million a month. I can't confirm or deny those, but we are growing at a significant rate across multiple regions, particularly in the regions that we now, as emerging markets, look after, which are LATAM and APAC.
So what do people do differently in Asia on Facebook than America or Europe? Are people's habits different?
I think it's really interesting because When I first started looking into emerging markets, we were always looking for the differences and coming into these new markets and then trying to find out what we need to do different in terms of user growth and in terms of engagement with brands and organisations. But you actually come here and you actually realise that the similarities are more apparent. So at the heart of Facebook is about connecting and engaging with the people that add value, the people and the things that add value to your life. That includes your friends, your family, and brands and organisations. And everybody wants to have that connection. So when people, when we talk about what's different in Asia, there's actually not that much different at the macro level. At the micro level, there are probably differences in terms of Japan, where it's a massive gaming platform rather than the connection platform. And again, gaming is
but in Japan, I thought in Japan, whenever I read about Japan, it's always like there's a challenge for Facebook because they like to be anonymous in Japan, right? It's Japan's not all about anonymity and, you know, dressing up in strange clothes. See? I can tell who's been to Japan. So you're saying Facebook in Japan is more of a gaming platform?
I said currently it's used as a gaming platform, but we have we now have a team in engineering team in Japan and some growth efforts that we're going there and really trying to understand the market and understand what Facebook needs to be. But at the same time, we're still growing very, very significantly in Japan as well. So, I mean, some of the perceptions that we have around the avatar and not wanting to be their real people, I mean, we're not quite sure if not that fully manifests itself. We're still figuring that out. So,
yeah, I mean, I remember a couple of years ago, Twitter was not big in Japan, and because you had to register online. So what they did was they made a mobile version, and the Twitter subscribers just went out the roof. So is that the same plans you have to move into mobile and forget about, you know, laptop-based access in Japan?
Excluding Japan, I mean, there's a question about our mobile proposition, our mobile strategy. Mobile is significantly important for us because if you think about what mobile is, it's probably the primary communication device. And in the future, it's going to be the primary media device. You have over 200 million active users using mobile.
And so that's 20%, right?
200 billion of 500 million.
Yeah.
More than 20%. Yeah.
Just testing. That's why I'm not a banker.
Neither am I, but I've got it right. So
Asians are better at math.
But mobile, so I'm not Asian either. So mobile, yeah, over 200 million active users on mobile. And what we see is actually the people who are on their mobile are 2.5 times more active, which is they share more and they consume more on the platform. And we're seeing, particularly in emerging markets, that mobile is going to be the primary way that people access the internet. Therefore, it's the primary way that they're going to use Facebook. Particularly in Indonesia, where mobile penetration is, 150%, 200%.
You know why that is? It's because I was in Jakarta recently. It's traffic jams. What do you do in a traffic jam? Look out the window, swear at the taxi driver, read the Asian Wall Street Journal, or get on Facebook?
Well, I've been to Indonesia. Most of them are on mopeds, so traffic jam doesn't seem relevant to them.
He's giving me a hard time.
You are.
Good on you, man. Good on you.
Good.
So mobile. Now let's get back.
So I haven't finished that question. So in terms of, you know, mobile is a very, very important thing. It's going to be the primary access for the internet, and it's something that we're really concentrating efforts on. But when people think about what mobile is, I mean, it's not just the way that you're going to access Facebook. If you think about Facebook as a platform, it's a way that you can be able to socialise all of your mobile experiences. So think about apps on the iPhone platform or the Android platform. Being able to really make those apps and experiences social on your mobile, as well as updating your status and updating photos and all of the great things you do on Facebook. So the way that we think about mobile is this hybrid cross-horizontal platform that whatever you do on mobile, you'll be able to have that really deep social experience on there.
So if it's mobile, how do you sell ads? I don't understand how, because like my mobile experience with Facebook is there's no ads. So how do you sell ads on mobile?
So I mean, the monetization of mobile isn't something. I'm on a microphone, so I can't speak up.
Hey, you lot at the back, could you quieten down so Trevor can then speak up? We'll balance it out.
In terms of monetization on the mobile, it's not something which is on our radar at the moment. We've still got a lot to do in terms of monetizing our website, and we're doing some really great things there, very different, unique experience. For us, mobile is about growth of users and growth of the development of the platform. So monetization is something which will come later. And to be honest with you, if you think about what mobile ads are, it's just putting these banner ads in mobile spaces. That's not necessarily the best experience. That's not an experience that we'd ever want to put as part of our mobile experience. So once we come up with something which is integrated into user experience and social, then that's something we would look at in terms of mobile. But there's still a lot to do on the platform. But if you think about what the marketing experience, the marketing proposition for Facebook is, it's about branded pages where people can publish into your newsfeed on a daily basis. That newsfeed is the same newsfeed that exists on your mobile experience. So when you think about what a market opportunity is, it's about how, as a brand, can you get into that newsfeed and have that social, relevant conversation and dialogue with people on the move or on Facebook, on the web.
So you're going to focus on the social feeds, right?
Social. I mean, social is at the heart of everything we do. It's what we are. And I don't know if many people have seen what our ad proposition is, but it's not about MPUs. It's not about banners. It's not about skies. It's about looking at what people are already doing on Facebook and allowing the brand to take that activity and add value to that daily activity and put social context and social advocacy at the heart of that brand presence on Facebook. And as long as it's integrated into user experience and adding value to that user, then the brand has every right to be part of that.
So how long have you been in Hong Kong?
In Hong Kong, I've been at Hong Kong since Monday, and I was out here maybe a month and a half ago. We did a tour for about a week prior to opening up.
So you met some brands here. How do you, in your dealings with brands here, how do you find it different from your dealings with brands in Europe?
It's not different, because all brands have the same challenges. It's globally, brands have the challenge about being able to reach consumers in new and unique ways in a competitive landscape where you have media fragmentation. You have all of challenges in terms of customer service and brand and retention. So the challenges across the globe are the same. The implementation may be a bit different, because you've got different types of media agencies and different types of support functions and different types of social media agencies. So, but what we're starting to see now is that the education is getting better. There's lots of companies that are springing up off the back of social that are filling the gaps. And there's lots of global education going on, people using Facebook in one country and sharing the findings across.
But I mean, in my experience here, the pages, you know, people coming, brands in Hong Kong say, I want a Facebook. How do you answer when somebody says, I want a Facebook?
The way I answer.
A brand.
The brand.
Says, I want, just give me a Facebook.
Yeah, I mean, we always want to, the way that we want to approach the market is have really deep strategic relationships with key brands and organisations. So rather than thinking about what's your social media strategy, it's thinking about what your marketing strategy is outside of how you're going to implement that, and then working out how social threads into that. So the conversation we always want to have is not whether or not they what their Facebook strategy should be. It's what is your brand issue? What are you trying to achieve over the course of this year and next year? And then work out how Facebook as a platform and as an ad platform or as a technological platform through pages, ads and technology can thread through that and start to really answer some of those marketing challenges.
So who's your favorite brand on Facebook? I like Trevor Johnson. Your page is pretty cool. You're just sitting in a really nice kind of tiger skin chair. Who's your favourite brand on Facebook?
Favourite brand? I haven't really got a favourite brand on Facebook. Is this okay? Can you still hear? Yeah?
Yeah.
I haven't really got a favourite brand on Facebook. I have favourite pages. Actually, my favourite page is the page of my local cafe. I live in this town called Streatham in southwest London. And the brands, the page has probably about 200 fans of it who are all in the local area. But Brad, who's the guy who runs the cafe, on a Friday, Saturday or Sunday morning will post into the newsfeed the menus, especially the day, particular vouchers. And that's really of relevance and hyper-local to me. And I can connect to that really local brand on a daily basis. And that's one of my favorite pages. That's 200 fans. And at the top,
what's it called?
It's called Perfect Blend.
Perfect Blend.
But at the top end, you've got brands like Starbucks, who have close to 20 million fans now. And the way that they use the platform is unbelievable. I mean, they use it to support all of the efforts they do outside of trying to get you to buy coffee. So when you go on there, they've got associations with Fair Trade. They've got associations with World AIDS Day, which they sponsor every month.
Sorry, can you just hold it?
Yeah.
Excuse me.
At the back, if you don't want to listen, there's a room next door with horses. Honestly, please, if you don't want to listen, get on Twitter, go next door. It's not going to last for a lot longer, but it's worth listening to.
So just back to Starbucks. I mean, everything they do on their page is to make you feel good about buying the brand when they put a call to action in your newsfeed or when you walk into their store. So if you look at it, 80% of their stuff isn't about trying to sell you coffee. It's about trying to make you feel good about the brand and trying to build this relationship with you. And that's a really compelling proposition, and that's a really great best practice to think about what social is and what Facebook is. It isn't about directly selling. It's not about CPCs and CPMs and all those things. It's about building a long-term relationship with the people that care about your brand and making them feel good about your brand when you're actually there to buy. And essentially talking about your brand to their friends. And that's a really good page in terms of best practice. That works whether you've got 20 million fans or if you've got 200 fans.
You made a good point. The problem is that all ad agencies, marketing agencies, PR agencies, media buying agencies are not set up to do what you just said. They make money. Media buying agencies make money from a markup of media. PR agencies make money by charging for time and media relations. Digital marketing agencies build websites. Your idea of long-term relationship building doesn't work with the advertising industry, or the advertising industry is not there yet.
I think the latter is true. I think there are some issues and challenges at the moment. The whole concept of social and community management does maybe sit aside from the whole monetization of how agencies do, which is around commissions and media spend. But what we're seeing is people making a significant shift to working out how they can start to deliver on their business and develop a business model that makes them able to deliver on the concept of social. And at the other end, you've got some of these smaller social media agencies or technology agencies that are starting to fill in the gap. And I think you'll probably see a lot of consolidation over the next year or two where some of the big agencies will acquire some of these smaller agencies. And new business models will develop off the back of it. I mean, one of the whole things that Mark Zuckerberg sees as Facebook is Facebook is a platform that's going to breed successful businesses. So there are going to be lots of successful businesses that are going to be able to capitalize on what social delivers to marketers and brands, and they're going to be able to monetize that. And they're going to do that through ways of moderation, through content development, through strategic marketing, which isn't about media. It's going to be maybe about time or maybe about performance. But we are going to see new business models and new companies formed off the back of what Facebook delivers.
You're right. We've had two of them in here. We had six waves. Is anybody here in social gaming? Kabam. Andy. Anybody else in social gaming? We had six waves in here. Have you heard of six waves?
I think I spoke to someone from six waves yesterday. Yeah.
They were very clever. They started off by making, when Facebook first launched, all of the content was in English, all of the games. So they launched them in Chinese, Russian, Spanish, Arabic, whatever, and they got 20 million users very quickly, started by two ex-Yahoo guys, and they were here, and that they have launched a whole business. They just a year ago raised $17 million, so which is a lot in this part of the world. Nothing in the US, but
yeah.
So you're right, they're doing well.
I mean, one of the best examples of that is Zynga. I mean, Zynga is probably one of the biggest gaming companies in the world, and underpinning that platform is Facebook. They have 100 million people using Cityville, and the interesting thing about Cityville is that they acquired 100 million people over 3 weeks. Farmville have...
That's remarkable. How do you get 100 million people in 3 weeks?
Farmville have 80 million active users, 80 million people on virtual farms, which is great, an interesting thing. And they're now bigger than places that people like EA. And if you think also Playfish is in there as well. They've got this social gaming site built off the back of the Facebook platform. So fundamentally what Mark did 2-3 years ago when he opened up the platform development was to do this thing, to create these massive companies that are off the back of our platform, that makes our platform long-term, sustainable and essential to both media and online and wherever.
So talking about gaming, you know, we live in Hong Kong. Hong Kong... We just care about money, isn't that right?
Yep.
Yeah. You don't. The rest of them do.
Exception.
So that you've got all these people playing games. So how is Facebook? There's this Facebook credits thing that kind of gets semi-launched, and so I walked.
I think it's launched.
It's launched.
Yeah.
So I went into a Circle K, you know, 24/7. I don't know what they sell. Anyway, and there was a sticker on the floor that said "Buy Facebook credits here." So is that? Do you see that as you know, a big area? Because in China, in Asia, the idea of you know, virtual items for games. There's some massive companies in China that build their business off the idea of upgrading, up leveling, getting bigger swords. Bigger swords, obviously.
Is that
where the direction you're going with the gaming industry is to become a provider of a payment system for the gaming industry?
Well, there's two questions there. One, I mean, yeah, QQ in China, $1 billion revenue, 800 million of those is virtual currency. So it's a really big established proposition. The global virtual currency business is going to be worth $10 billion globally this year, and growing significantly. The way that we see credits is probably two things. One is allowing developers and game developers on the Facebook platform to easily monetize their games. So we offer a way for them to integrate Facebook credits. People can buy those credits and spend those credits in game, and we take a commission.
How much is that commission?
You'd have to get
through
to our developer wiki.
30? Yeah, it's Steve Jobs. What's wrong with that?
And the second way is that we very much see our role as really driving that, so everyone on our platform can benefit. So it's about the credits has been locked in a closed beta to specific developers, and now it's opened up to other developers, and primarily, well, 100% on gaming, because we very much see that away as really accelerating that market, and for all the people that are building these great things on our platform to be able to benefit from that.
You know that you mentioned Tencent. QQ had a problem in China because the gaming QQ currency became an alternative currency. So they got very worried because the exchange rate between the renminbi, and you know how much the Chinese like to control the renminbi, and the QQ cents. So do you think there'll be a situation where Mark Zuckerberg was sitting out there next to the, I don't know, name some big finance guy, the Bank of Europe or whatever, and saying, hey, you know, my currency, we need to talk about currency exchange rates. Will it become an issue?
I'm not in a position to answer that. I don't know much about Forex and cross trading issues. And
you save the questions for later, please, Mr. Burton. So, the gaming, I think, is a really interesting area. Let's talk about, you mentioned earlier Hyperlocal and your local coffee shop, Perfect Blend. Yeah, you know, in Hong Kong, there's a lot of hyper-local stuff. You know, you probably see, you walk down the street, there's 15 shops selling the same thing. It's hyper, hyper-local. So, when are you going to launch Facebook Places here? I know there's a lot of frustrated people here that want to check in. Who's checked in here? What did you use to check in?
Foursquare.
Now, Foursquare actually doesn't have that many users in Hong Kong. They're all white. Foursquare apparently doesn't have as many as Jiepang, which has 6,000. Jiepang is a Chinese copycat. So yeah, when are you going to launch Facebook Places?
So the way we approach the rollout of products and services is we're a small company, right? So whenever we haven't got that many engineers, we've got a few, but not that many engineers. So when we do launch products such as Places, they will predominantly work in the US first because it's close to home. They can see if there are any problems or any faults in the product, and then they can roll that out slowly. We launched Places and Deals in Europe.
Can you explain Deals for the people at the back who are talking really loudly? Could you explain deals? Because I don't quite understand how deals work.
So deals is, if you think about the concept of checking into a place, if you check into a Starbucks, Starbucks can set up a deal that whenever you check in, you can either get loyalty points or you can get a money off voucher for something in store. So it's a way to really enhance that check-in experience. So we launched place deals in a couple of the major markets in Europe 1 or 2 weeks ago. We are looking to launch places wider as soon as we're ready to. So at some point, places will be available in other markets. We just can't tell you when.
Let me. I saw there's actually a browser. Touch.facebook.com is where you can access deals.
Places.
Sorry. Wrong source. When I was in Jakarta, it was quite funny. There's Foursquare in Jakarta. People have worked out how to go onto Foursquare's website and log into Paris or London without actually being there. So Foursquare has been gamed by the Indonesians. Do you think the same will happen with you guys, or are you a bit smarter than that?
I'm not an engineer, so I don't really understand the ins and outs of gaming and hacking.
Nice one. So let's talk about politics. It's you deal with EMEA, and I got some...
Emerging markets now. We've moved across from EMEA to emerging markets.
Is Middle East called emerging market?
Middle East is part of EMEA.
All right, so what? I'm going to ask you a question. I got some stats here. In the Middle East, in 1 year, you've gone from 12 million to 21 million users. That's incredible. And what's unusual, it's two men to one woman. Now, considering that most women have got to wear burqas and hide inside, I understand that. Now, in Egypt, recently, 5 million users and 32,000 groups were set up in 2 weeks, 14,000 pages, which is incredible. So, is Facebook becoming, you know, the de facto gathering point for grassroots uprisings?
I don't think so. No, it's the same way that mobile phone and text messaging is the way to organise people, and Twitter. They all have a role to play. I mean, Facebook is one of those communication platforms that allow people to communicate across multiple locations, and so it is going to be used for those sorts of things. But so in the same way that Twitter is, in the same way that notes are and email is, I think they all have a really good role to play. And it's given, Facebook is just allowing people to communicate more and giving the power of distribution and information to people. I don't think that we're the de facto thing in that, but we do have an increasingly significant part to play in that, in the same way as mobile does and the same way as email does.
So there's been a lot of talk in the press recently about Americans talking up, you know, social media as changing the Middle East. Who agrees that the Middle East would change even if Facebook was not around? Yeah. If Facebook and Twitter did not exist, would we have uprisings in the Middle East now?
Yes.
Now that Facebook and Twitter exist, is this making a difference?
Yes.
Even. Good one. Well, we won't know, because the problem with people on social media is they talk too much. So,
if it wasn't making a difference, they wouldn't have shut down the internet.
All right, we've got some hecklers here. If it wasn't making a difference, they wouldn't have shut down the internet.
They wouldn't have.
It's part of communication. If people haven't got Facebook, they're going to do it by mobile phone. If they haven't got to do it by mobile phone, they're going to do it by word of mouth. It'll take longer to do, but it's still about passing information along.
Okay, so let's look at, you've had some products that you've launched that I've got a bit confused about. So you had, you know, the cold Q&A space? So LinkedIn did LinkedIn answers, Yahoo got all kind of answered up. Oh, what's happening here, sorry. There we go. And then you kind of launched Facebook Q&A, or answers, and I was on it for a while and then it kind of disappeared. What's happened? Is it you testing it, or is it going to come out? But tell us a little bit about, because you've got so many people doing so much stuff. Have you got products like Answers? Are you a bit like Google, where you kind of get some engineers who try something out on a Friday, and then if it doesn't work, you withdraw, like a good Catholic?
So we release
Old.
How many of you are Catholic?
So we release code every single week on Facebook. Every single week we release some things. The culture of engineering is to fail quickly. So we'll test and learn lots of things on the fly on Facebook. That will include products and services, or that may include just little changes on the platform that you may or may not notice. Questions is still around. It's still a product in beta. And it's still a product that is available to a subset of our users. The future of that I'm not completely over, but it's still a product that exists, and it's still a product that we're looking at and testing.
It obviously didn't work, because some of your guys left and set up Quora, right? And Quora's kind of getting a lot of action now, but I think it's one
not,
of those...
I'm not sure they left because questions didn't work. I'm not sure. I'm not sure that's the reason why they left.
Probably not. I'm simplifying things. I'm sorry. I had to do that. So, in Facebook, there's a whole charity element. And, you know, we give 10% of what all you lot have paid to charity. So, tell me more about the charity element of Facebook. I think it's a huge, huge side. The whole social entrepreneurship. Tell us a little bit more about that side.
So, the element of causes is a massive thing on Facebook. And actually, some of the biggest brands and organisations that are successful on Facebook are ones that are tied into causes. So, if you think about Kellogg's, who's going to be a fan of Kellogg's, right? But there are about 4 million fans of Kellogg's and Facebook, because they wrap their brand around this concept called Hungry America, where their task of feeding hungry people in America. Again, Chase Bank, not exactly the most riveting thing to become a fan of, but they have this whole concept of community giving, where they actually action their fans to decide where they're going to spend $5 million at a local level within their community. So if you think about what causes on Facebook does, it just taps into the human instinct of wanting to be careful and so careful. I mean, careful, full of care,
caring for
people. And Facebook is a great way for people to do that, to express their care and to be able to donate using applications such as the causes application or using Just Giving. It's just a very simple, easy way to donate and engage with things that are of interest. And the Amnesty International page is huge. The Red, the American Express Red is huge. So it's something which really resonates with just human nature.
So can I ask you some numbers? How many of you have donated money on Facebook? God, mean fuckers. Donate money on Facebook. So how many people use causes? Do you know?
The causes application, I haven't looked at it recently, but it was something around 30 or 40 million, I think.
So when you talk about, you gave examples of Kellogg's and stuff like that. Do you have any idea the kind of money that is going through there to charity or not?
I don't know the specifics, but I do know they have 4 million fans that they can have a dialogue and really drive awareness of Hungry America, and that awareness may manifest itself in donations on Facebook, or it may manifest itself in donations offline. So we can't track that. But again, when you have a social marketing or a relationship forum, it's not about measuring every single transaction, because it has an influence both online and offline.
So let's talk about data again, because you know, you have amazing amounts of data. And I remember in 2009 there was the Gross National Happiness Index, right? Which was, you know, I work for a PR firm and we spend day in, day out measuring what people think about brands. And you had this thing for the US called the Gross National Happiness Index, which, you know, basically mined whether Americans were happy or not. Are you going to launch this in Asia? I want to see more of the data. When are you going to give me more of the data from Facebook? When can I go in and find out whether people are happy?
The way that we look at data is two things. One is to help us decide what's working on Facebook and help us make those prioritizations in terms of products and things that we want to do to make the platform better. And the second thing is, every now and then when we may dip into to have a look and see some of the more social things, some of the more community things that happen on Facebook, because people are expressing their feelings and expressing all of those things on Facebook. So sometimes we may, at an aggregate level, take a few million people and have a look at that, but it's always at the aggregate level. The other way that we view data is to allow brands and organizations to really understand the impact that they're having with their consumers, with their fans. And again, that's always at an aggregate level. we understand that the more a brand can know about people and the people they're engaging with, the better they can optimize their products and services and marketing messages to those people. So it's a very important thing that brands want from Facebook. But data is about a value exchange. We never give it at an individual level. We never take stuff that is uber private. And it's always about making sure that it's the best for the consumer and the user who's at the heart of our platform, rather than anyone else.
You didn't really answer my question there, but that's all right.
Maybe I asked, what was the question?
you shared data, so it was aggregated data. It was North America, and basically you were saying, you know, people's level of happiness. So, you know, when will you start? I'm not an advertiser, but I want to look at people in Hong Kong, and I want to see, are they happy at Chinese New Year because they've got an extra lycée packet? Or, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's generic. Yeah. You have access. When are you going to open up an API when I can pull off generic data that I can use to show how humans are feeling at this moment in time?
So I don't know if we're ever going to do that, but if we do that, it will have to add value to the Facebook experience, to our users, as opposed to a brand or organization or someone as yourself just wants to have a seat. It's not the culture of Facebook and that. It's about, is it useful to our users? Is that useful? I don't know.
So you talked about privacy, and I find it really weird. Every time Facebook has an issue with privacy, you gain 100 million new users. So who in this room actually has something to hide? Five of you. Six of you. Seven. That is adding slowly. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So they can't work out whether they have stuff to hide or not. Why is it such an issue?
And why
is it such an issue? Is it not an issue?
I don't think privacy is an issue. That word privacy is an issue. I think control is the issue. I don't think we've traditionally been good at communicating the controls that people have over their profiles. So they've always had full control over the information that they share and who they share that with. That's always been part of the Facebook platform. Privacy is at the heart of what we do. If we don't have that, if we don't have that trust, then people wouldn't use it and people would leave. I think it's been about control, and a lot of the things that have come out have been about us trying to demonstrate that control, maybe not in the best way. And I think the product guys would maybe say that was the case. But I don't think it's privacy. It's being able to share the data you want with the people that you want, and that's at the core of what we do. But there's also, and as Mark would say, there's a movement to redefining what privacy is. People want to share more and more things on the internet. If you think about 10 years ago, you'd never share your mobile phone or even your email address on the internet. Now think about the things you share every day to people that you know, and for some people in this room, people that you don't know. I mean, some people have friends on Facebook that they don't even know, and they're still willing to share all that stuff with them. So there's very much a movement towards redefining what privacy is in the modern day. So there's those two things: the definition of what privacy is and what people want to share, and allowing people to do that, but also giving them the control to be able to share the things they want with the people that they want.
Nice answer. All right, questions from the floor. Let's take a question. Hands up if you've got a question.
What about China?
Where's that? That wasn't a question. That was somebody shouting from the middle of the room. Put your hand up if you've got a question. Say who you are, who you work for, and your question.
Hi, I'm Gene Su, the co-founder of Startups HK and also founder of Style Nearby. So since I'm a co-founder of Startups HK, I want to ask a question about startups. Facebook recently announced Startup Days in the United States for startups in the U.S., you know, in your plans in expanding in Asia, emerging markets, is there any plans to announce something similar to that for Asian startups?
You mean like F8, right? The Developers Conference, is that
no,
what you mean?
No. Yeah. So we have a concept called Developer Garage, where people that are building great stuff on the Facebook platform can come together and talk about that. That exists in maybe 25 different markets across the globe. In the US, that's an evolution of the developer garage concept, which exists. Whether that will be in Asia, I can't confirm or deny that. But the more and more that we have people on the ground here, the more and more conversations we have on the ground here, the more and more we want to engage with the developer community and the startup community, the people that are building great things to exist in our platform and making it more of a reason for people to go onto Facebook. So the concept is we'd love to engage in that community. I don't know what format that will be in, and I don't know when, but it's definitely something we want to do.
Start one yourself, mate. Next question.
Hi, my name is Elias. I'm Digital Creative Director, and I have a question about the sponsored stories. Don't get me wrong, you seem like a clever dude, and I love Facebook as a person, also as a creative director, but why is it so hard for Facebook to find interesting stuff or interesting cheap methods of monetizing or something to offer to agencies? Because a sponsored story, in my opinion, is just something to clutter the right column of my Facebook experience. This doesn't add anything. Doesn't add anything color or any graphics or whatever. Why is it so hard for you to offer something that's not as expensive as a new game on Facebook?
So just so people understand the concept of sponsored stories, if you think about when something, well, your friend does something and it creates what we call an organic impression that appears in your newsfeed. So if my boss Blake becomes a fan of something, or he checks into a particular restaurant, or if he does something on Facebook, RSVPs to an event, that creates what we call an organic story, which will go into my newsfeed. Now, I've got a lot of friends and who create a lot of content, and I use Facebook quite a lot, so it goes into my newsfeed and it disappears quite quickly. What sponsored stories allows a person or a brand or advertiser to do is to take that organic story that would have already appeared in that friend's newsfeed and pin it to the right-hand side. So if Nike are creating an event about a launch of a new boot, and Blake RSVPs to that event, Nike can then pay to have that story pinned to the right-hand side of the screen. What we found in terms of our advertising is that organic stories are much more impactful and much more effective than the paid for media, so that earned media. And what this allows you to do is amplify that earned media. So while it may not be creative and flashy and an MPU and a banner, it fundamentally does what a marketer wants to do, which is have that word of mouth marketing at scale. Take those organic or earned impressions and make sure people can see those, the social context. Because the research that we've seen is that social context and social advocacy increases the value of your media. They're much more likely to remember the ad, they're much more likely to engage with the ad, they're much more likely to be advocates of your brand, and they're much more likely to purchase your brand. So being able to allow brands to take that earned media and amplify that even further, we think is a very powerful proposition. It may not be as creative as you want it to be, but it solves an issue that brands want to have.
Mate, just get creative on the pages. There's a lack of it in Hong Kong, I tell you. More questions?
I'll see who else has got a question.
All right, you're at the front. Sorry, we'll come back to you later.
Are there any questions at the back? Because everyone out here is getting the glory.
Any questions at the back?
Any questions? There's a few at the back.
Can you scream? The girl here by the television screen, can you scream?
Just do word of mouth. Pass it to the front.
Pass it to the front. Chinese whispers.
So if I understand the question, you're saying that within Asia, people have a tighter network of friends geographically, right? And whether or not that impacts the way that we think about how we approach the market.
Well, you have also fewer friends.
So that particular issue, probably no. The average number of friends that a Facebook user has is 150. That's a global thing. There's some markets where it's significantly over that, and some markets where it's significantly below that. the number of friends we don't necessarily think should be a factor in how we approach market and the conversations we have, because it is about connecting with the people and things you care about the most, whether that's 500 people or if that's 150 people. So whether or not we think about things differently because of that factor, not at the moment. I'm not going to say in the long term that we're not going to maybe consider that, but at the moment it's not a significant factor in how we approach the market and the conversations we have.
All right, we're in the middle here. Who's got a question? Trevor, can you speak louder, because we can't actually hear you very well here.
Sorry.
Who's got a question? She looks like a journalist. She's got a pad and a pen, and she's got media on her chest. So what's your question? Be nice.
So what about China?
Who are you? Who do you work for? And what's your question?
So my question is, what about China?
Who do you work for?
AsianCorrespondent.com. AsianCorrespondent.com. Jennifer Matson.
So what about China? Be more specific.
What is Facebook's strategy in China?
I'm sure he's not going to share that, but... Mate,
I mean, the way that we think about the world is connecting people across the world regardless of market. And you can use Facebook in multiple languages, as that includes all dialects of Chinese. And there are gaps globally.